Just one second. How about now? Lot better. Okay. All right, well, good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I'd like to welcome you all that are here and those joining us via the live webcast to the North Carolina Department of Transportation's formal corridor public hearing for the Complete 540 project, also known as Transportation Improvement Program Project Numbers R-2721, R-2828, and R-2829. My name is Jamil Robbins. I am a Public Involvement Officer with the Department of Transportation, and I will be your moderator for tonight's public hearing. Real quick, some housekeeping. Restrooms are out the door to the left and to your left, and just past the signing table, there's a doorway, a hallway. There's restrooms there. There are also restrooms just outside to your right in the hallway. If you have a cell phone on, please turn to silent. These are formal proceedings. We are recording. And if you don't want to interrupt that, there's a ringtone. As far as ground rules go, I used to have a long laundry list of rules for public hearings, and I realized they can all be condensed into just one main rule, and that is the golden rule. That is to treat others as you would like to be treated. And that is very appropriate in a public forum such as this, especially when we get to the public comment period, because there are differing opinions on this project. If someone gets up to speak and their comments are differing, different from your opinions, don't boo them or heckle them from the crowd. Please provide them the same respect that you would like if you got up to speak. All right, real quick, I do want to recognize the staff that are here tonight. There's too many to go name by name in the interest of time, but all the people in green shirts have done a lot of work, a lot of hard work went into the preparation for these public meetings and public hearings. So I just wanted to recognize them. I do want to recognize a few people in particular. Our division engineer, Mr. Joey Hopkins, and our division construction engineer, Mr. Dennis Journey. I'd also like to recognize our NCDOT project planning manager, Mr. Eric Lincoln, and our NCDOT roadway project manager, Mr. Tony Hauser. And I would also like to recognize our director of the Turnpike Authority, Mr. Bo Memmer. And I would be remiss if I didn't recognize all the hard work by our consultant team, H.W. Lochner and HNTB, Mr. Roy Bruce, Jeff Slaughter, Kristen Mason, and Ms. Kirsten Bass and Jennifer Harris with HNTB. We also have several local officials, elected officials here tonight. You know, State Representative Nelson Dollar is here, and State Senator Chad Barefoot. And then we have several mayors from Holly Springs, Fuquay, and the town of Garner here tonight, and their town councils, town staff. So I would like to thank them all for coming out tonight as well. So let's go ahead and get started. And I'm going to do a brief overview of what to expect from tonight's hearing. So I'm going to flip the books. To start with the purpose of tonight's hearing and your role in that process, we'll do a project overview. We'll talk about the project alternatives. We'll talk about costs and impacts of those alternatives, the right-of-way acquisition process, and the next steps in the project development process, And then we get to the most important part of tonight, and that's the public comment portion. Again, this is a public hearing. You've come out here, what you have to say. Now, the purpose of tonight's hearing is simply to make you, the public, a part of the project development process. This is an important step in our continual efforts to make you a part of this process. Well, so specifically tonight, we want to get your input on the draft environmental impact statement that was prepared, that is the environmental document that is prepared for this project. We'll talk a little bit about the why of the project in transportation terms, that is known as the purpose and need. We'll present the detailed study alternatives to you and get your input on those alternatives. Now, the main focus of this round of public hearings is to select the location for this project. So selecting an alternative. Currently we have 17. We want to get that down to one alternative. And so your input is vital in that aspect. We really don't want to get into any design questions tonight because that's really not the focus of this public hearing. I know you've seen the public hearing maps and you've seen functional designs in those corridors. A lot can change when we actually get into the next phase of this project. Now, copies of the draft environmental impact statement, or DEIS, and the maps that you've seen here tonight have been available at the following locations. And all this is in your handout. Well, does everyone have a handout? Okay. And copies of the DEIS only have been available at the following locations. Now, I can't stress enough the importance of public participation in this process. And you participate by making your voices heard. You do that several ways. We provide a lot of different options for you to provide input. You can submit written comments here tonight. In each packet, there was a comment form. You can fill that out, leave it here tonight. You have until January 8th to submit comments. You can go home, take time to formulate your ideas, and send those in to us. You can submit your comments via email. You can fax your comments to us. You can also submit your comments via the online public engagement software tool we are using, known as My Sidewalk. You can also engage with your fellow citizens on that site. And we also, on our project website, we have an interactive comment form that you could fill out. And you can also have your comments recorded here tonight during this formal proceeding. And also we had oral comment station at the public meetings this week. So if you didn't want to write your comments, you were able to just speak into the mic and we will at the oral comment station and we'll have those transcribed as well. And in an effort to broaden the outreach and participation for citizens, we are streaming the presentation live via web. And for those of you that are attending on via the webcast, you can submit your comments in the question box, and we will take those in as public comments. So you may be asking, what is done with your input? Well, in about 6 to 8 weeks from now, NCDOT staff and various branches, all of which play a role in the development of this project, will convene to discuss each and every comment that we've received through the public comment period. Again, that's January the 8th. So we'll go through each one of those comments and prepare a response to those comments. And we will incorporate public comment into the, our decision on a recommended alternative. Now, I want to be clear that the department cannot just take public comment into consideration when making these decisions. We have to balance that against good, sound engineering criteria. We have to balance that with safety, which is our number one goal. The impacts to the natural and human environment. We have to look at cost and traffic service as well. So it's a very complex balancing act, but we do have a lot of practice in it. But what that allows us to do is put the best product we can on the ground for the citizens of North Carolina. Now, as I stated earlier, we do hope to come out of this post-hearing meeting with a recommended alternative. Following the post-hearing meeting, we will meet with our agency partners. Those are various state and federal regulatory and resource agencies, such as the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers, the U.S. EPA, U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service, State Historic Preservation Office, the Capital Area Metropolitan Planning Organization, CAMPO, just to name a few. But we will meet with them to discuss all the public and agency comments, and we hope to come out of that meeting with a preferred alternative. Following the selection of the preferred alternative, we will do a major media blitz to announce that selection and the reasons for that selection. We'll send a newsletter out to everyone on the mailing list. We'll also, it'll be announced on the website. We'll work with the local municipalities as well to get the word out. It's not lost on us that a lot of people have been encumbered by this project, living in the shadow of this project coming for quite a while, so it's we do hope to make that decision in the spring. We hope to reach a selected alternative in the spring of 2016. Now, this is a federal aid highway project. Traditionally, under that program, the feds pay 80% of the cost of the project, and the state pays 20%. Well, the CAMPO, or the Capital Area Metropolitan Planning Organization, identified the Complete 540 project as a toll facility. So tolling is an additional funding source in that for this project. And by committing to tolling, we will be able to deliver this project many years ahead of traditional funding sources. Now let's get back to the why of the project. Again, transportation terms as purpose and need for the project. Now, this area, the Raleigh-Cary area, has grown by 52% since just 2000. And it's continuing to grow. North Carolina is a great place to live. This is a great area. So people are coming. We're seeing a lot of development in the area. And with all that growth, it puts a strain on our existing transportation structure. And so with that, there are more, we need more route choices. We also need to reduce the congestion on our existing roadway network. So with that said, the purpose of this project is twofold. One, to improve the mobility within and through the project study area during peak travel periods, and two, to reduce forecast congestion on the existing roadway network within the project study area. Now, the secondary benefit is improved system linkage or system connectivity within the existing roadway network. Now, the proposed improvements are consistent with the long-range transportation plans for the local municipalities within the study area. local governments within the Capital Area Metropolitan Planning Organization, or CAMPO, again, as well as NCDOT, have included this project in their adopted plans. Again, the project is the completion of the 540 outer loop around the greater Raleigh area. This will extend the project from its western terminus or endpoint at NC 55 eastward to its eastern, current eastern endpoint at US 264. It is proposed as a six-lane median divided freeway with full control of access. That means access to and from the new roadway will be via interchange only. That means no private driveways will be allowed to connect to the roadway. And as I said before, it is identified as a toll facility, just like you have on NC 540 now. The tolling will be captured electronically, as it is today. Let's talk about the detailed study alternatives. You'll see there are 10 color-coded segments that can be combined in various ways to assemble 17 detailed study alternatives. There are 4 western routes, and there are 5 eastern routes. So we'll go through each detailed study alternative. And I will just kind of point out some of the major advantages and disadvantages for each one. And I'll, instead of detailed study alternative, I'll use the acronym DSA. Okay? So detailed study alternative 1, it consists of a combination of the orange and green route. Now, the advantage that all of the orange routes have is that it follows a protected corridor that has been protected since 1995. So development within that corridor has been limited. And as a result, the orange routes have fewest relocations compared to other routes. Now, one of the disadvantages of the orange route is that it has higher wetland impacts. It also crosses a portion of Swift Creek that is adjacent to or through the livable habitat for a federally protected species, which is the dwarf wedge mussel. And the green route avoids any use of any public lands. However, impact a small communications tower, and it may impact one of a group of large communication towers. It also bisects the planned Ramley Farm property. It is a planned mixed-use community. It actually goes right through the middle of that. Now, DSA 2 is the orange, green and mint combination. The mint impacts the communication towers as well, but it shifts the impacts to the Randy Farm property further to the east, more toward the eastern edge of that property. DSA 3, which is the orange, brown, tan, green combination, the tan corridor shifts impacts to the Ramley Farm property to the east as well. It also avoids the communications tower. The tan corridor, the disadvantage of the tan corridor is that it can cause more disruption to more homeowners. It also impacts historic eligible historic property known as the Baldwin Stallings House. And it also impacts the northwest corner of the Clemens Educational State Forest. DSA 4 is the orange-brown-green combination. The brown route avoids the communications towers and avoids the Randy farm property. The disadvantages of the brown route is that it impacts several municipal properties, the Raleigh Police Department's training facility, the spray field, and the Neuse River Water Treatment Plant, and those are the two main impacts there. DSA 5, the orange, green, teal, brown combination. Teal avoids the Raymond farm property as well, but it will still impact those communications towers. And it will impact the spray field at the Neuse River Wastewater Treatment Plant as well, and the RPD training facility. Now, DSA 6 is the orange, red, green combination. The benefit to the red route is that it has the least amount of wet impacts. It also crosses upstream of the dwarf wedge mussel habitat. However, it does impact two watersheds, and these red routes also have 69% more residential relocations as compared to the orange route. It also impacts two eligible historic resources, the Dr. L.J. Fall Harbor, I hope I'm saying that correct, farm in the Bryant Farms Historic District. And it also has serious negative impacts on land use and planning objectives and desired development patterns. Detailed DSA 7 is the orange, red, mint, green combination. All right, detailed study, alternative 8, actually alternatives 8 through 12 have the purple-blue combination. The benefits of the purple-blue combination in combination with the buyback have the fewer wetland impacts. The purple-blue combination also provides better access to the growing areas near Fuquay. The disadvantages of the purple-blue combination, again, detailed study, alternatives 8 through 12, is that it results in 108% increase in residential relocations over the orange routes. It also affects some planned parks in Sunset Oaks Park in the Southeast Regional Park. It also has negative impacts to the town of Holly Springs and Wake County land use plans. And the Lilac Corridor directly impacts the Dempsey Benton Water Treatment Plant. So DSA 9 again is the orange, purple, blue, lilac, green, mint combination. DSA 10 is the orange, purple, blue, lilac, brown, tan, green combination. DSA 11 is the orange, purple, blue, lilac, brown, green combination. 12 is the orange, purple, blue, lilac, green, teal, brown combination. Oops, that's too far. Now, DSA 13 is the orange, actually 13. 13 through 17, all have, all use the full lilac corridor. As a result, it has 76% more relocations over the orange lots. So DSA 13 is the orange, lilac, green. DSA 14 is orange, lilac, green, mint. DSA 15 is orange, lilac, brown, tan, green. 16 is orange, lilac, brown, green. And 17, finally, is the orange, lilac, green, teal, brown. Now, for more information on the, more detailed information on those impacts, feel free to pick. You can view this online. This is the draft environmental impact statement. All that, all the different impacts are listed in here. So let's talk a little bit about project cost and impacts. This evaluation matrix is in your handout. I'm not going to take the time to go through that entire matrix, but I will touch on two important factors in that. That is the cost estimate. For the various alternatives range anywhere from roughly $2.2 billion to $2.6 billion. The lowest is alternative 2 at nearly $2.2 billion. And the highest is alternative 12 at nearly $2.6 billion. Relocations range anywhere from 243 to 569 relocations, the lowest being alternative 4, and the highest being alternative 9. Now, section 4F is a federal law that offers protection to publicly owned parks, recreation facilities, wildlife refuges, and historic sites. Now, there is a provision in Section 4F that states that if you have a minor impact to a Section 4F property, that an avoidance alternative is not needed as long as you can prove that it is a minor impact, also known as a de minimis impact. And we have three of those properties. One is the Middle Creek School Park. The other is the Watershed Extension Loop Trail in Clinton's Educational State Forest and the Neuse River Trail. A little bit about the right-of-way acquisition phase process. Again, it's still a little early to be talking about right-of-way acquisition. First, want to again pick the location of this project. Those corridors that I just went through are all 1,000 feet in width. The actual project would only be about a third of that size, so about 300 feet, again, wider at interchange locations. So, but we studied that 1,000 foot area so that we know the constraints within those, environmental constraints within those corridors. So when we start moving toward more detailed designs, we know what's out there, and in essence, the actual roadway design could snake anywhere in between that 1,000 foot corridor. But I still want to let you know about our right-of-way acquisition phase. We will be back out with a design public hearing. We will be looking at the particular impacts design on properties at that time, and that would be a more appropriate time to be concerned about the right-of-way acquisition. But once decisions are made regarding final design, the limits of the project will be staked in the ground, and if you are an affected property owner, a right-of-way agent will arrange a meeting with you to discuss the project with you, how it affects you, and your rights as a property owner. The permanent right-of-way is required from you, then an appraisal will be done on your property. And the current market value of that property at its highest and best use will be offered as monetary compensation. Now, during this process, the department must treat all owners and tenants equally. We must fully explain an owner's rights. We must pay just compensation in exchange for property rights. And we must provide relocation advisory assistance. That is, if you are a relocatee, you are going to be displaced as a result of this project. Additional assistance in the form of advice and monetary compensation is available. And we do have our right-of-way agents here. They are the experts on that subject. So if you have any detailed right-of-way questions, feel free to meet with them after the public hearing. Or if you have any right-of-way questions, just send those in on your, with your comments. Next steps. The draft EIS review and public comment period ends on January the 8th. Again, we hope to have a preferred alternative selected in the spring of 2016. The final EIS, which is the next environmental document, and the record of decision, which is the final environmental document in this process, yet to be the dates are yet to be determined, but we do know that those documents have to be and will be completed in time for us to meet the anticipated let date or construction contract award date in 2018. Now, the project will be awarded as a design-build project. The design-build process is still a fairly new project delivery method for the Department of Transportation. It differs from our traditional project delivery method, which is, you know, we go through planning and design, we complete the final design plans, the right-of-way plans for the project. We allot 18 to 24 months to purchase all of the right-of-way needed to construct that project, and then we begin construction. Well, the industry realized there are a lot of efficiencies that could be made up in that time frame. So what the design-build process allows us to do is contract with a team of designers and contractors to be responsible not only for the final design of the project, but the right-of-way acquisition of the project, as well as the construction of the project. So in essence, a design-build team can be constructing one portion of the project, buying right-of-way in another, and finishing the final design in yet another portion of the project. And we've seen that lead to faster completion dates. We've also seen a lot of innovative designs come out of the design-build process that further reduce cost and impact. And we've also seen quick resolutions to issues that arise during the construction phase. And anyone that's been involved in construction, whether it be a home improvement project or some major construction project, is not a question of if an issue will arise, it's when. So the design-build process is a very efficient and very good process for us. All right, so enough of me talking. We've reached the most important part of the project, of the public hearing, that is the public comment phase. We're asking everyone to come up to the mic that is in the middle of the room here. When you come up, please state your name and address, and I will call everyone up in order in which we receive sign up. And one other thing I failed to mention, minutes of that post-hearing meeting, where we go through each and every comment and prepare a response, a summary of those minutes will be prepared. So if you want to see what was discussed at that meeting, the responses to the various comments, put a note, put a note on your comment that you would like a copy of those post-hearing meeting minutes. All right?